Amen. Let the church say amen. Amen. You may be seated. Grace and peace to you from God the Father, Jesus Christ, our blessed Lord and Savior, and the sweet, sweet Holy Spirit. It is indeed good to be in church, even on a Thursday night, is it not? On tonight, I just want to lift up in your hearing for a few moments the subject, the body and the blood of Christ. The body and the blood of Christ. Won't you please pray with me? Oh Lord, our God, come be with this your servant as I seek to break the bread of life before your people. Have your people to know that I am nothing, absolutely nothing apart from you, but indeed you're everything. So please, Lord Jesus, use this, your earthen vessel, as an instrument of your divine love to proclaim your holy and righteous word so that those who are wounded will be healed, those who are bound, delivered, and those who are captive will be set free in the mighty name of Jesus the Christ. Let the church say, amen. The year was approximately 30 AD. The place was Jerusalem, where hundreds of thousands of pilgrims had ascended to offer their sacrifices at the temple and celebrate the Passover festival. It was a day of preparation, a day, as Mark reminds us in his gospel, that the Passover lambs were sacrificed. And the disciples of Jesus came to him asking where they were to prepare the Passover celebration. With so many visitors in the city, one must wonder why Jesus and his disciples didn't just retreat a couple of miles to the village of Bethany, where his friends Mary and Martha and Lazarus lived. Only a short time earlier, Jesus had raised his friend from the dead, and word had spread quickly to the city of Jerusalem, where some were glorifying God, but then there were others who were plotting to kill Jesus. There was a plan about to unfold, and it required Jesus to be in the holy city. And it was to begin with a Passover meal celebrated within a section of the city known as Mount Zion. Most likely, Mount Zion was in the midst of the Essene colony within the city of Jerusalem. The Essenes were a separatist sect of men in Judaism who lived in desert conclaves, practicing an ascetic, celibate lifestyle. They were known as the Sons of the Light. Somebody say the Sons of the Light. Most biblical scholars believe that this Passover was in this section of the city because of one small clue. Jesus tells his disciples to go into the city and follow a man carrying a water jar. Now get this, this was a clue because men did not carry water jars except if there were no women. That means in all likelihood, the light of the world celebrated his final meal with his disciples in the home of one of the sons of the light. Passover was a time to remember that on their final night in Egypt, death passed over the households of the Israelite who smeared the blood of a lamb over the doorpost. That night, death came to the firstborn of Egypt, but not to the Israelites who were protected by the blood of the lamb. On the night of the Last Supper with his disciples, it was not known to the disciples, but the blood of another lamb was about to save them, not just from death for one night, but to save them from death throughout all of eternity. How significant that Jesus chose the day of the sacrifice of the lambs to share this symbolic and holy meal with his disciples. One would think that the freedom from Egyptian bondage would then become the freedom from the bondage of sin, linking those two together forever and ever. Each of the Gospels gives us some significant insight into the events of that night. Three of the Gospels mention that the meal took place in an upper room within the city of Jerusalem. The upper room today is marked by a simple room that was a crusader's church. The vaulted ceiling and marble asp at the one side hardly reminiscent of what it would have actually looked like in Jesus's day. But their purpose was not to actually recreate the upper room, but to mark an authentic spot where the faithful can remember and celebrate the final night of Jesus. Being a Passover Seder, the meal would have been eating reclining, with each of the guests leaning on their left arm and leaning rather on their left arm and eating with their right hand. As we were preparing for the night, one of the ushers asked me, where we gonna eat it? I was like, well, some of us might get down and lean on our left arm and try to eat with our right hand, but we might not be able to get up. So we're not gonna reenact it quite that way on tonight. But he did this reclining action as though they were reclining at the table. Their legs and their feet would have been extended outwardly. Such details might seem insignificant, but will become important as the story progresses. Unlike the image we have of Da Vinci's Last Supper, with Jesus sitting in the center of a very long table, Middle Eastern custom would have dictated that the disciples and Jesus would have sat at a three-sided table called a triclinium. Anybody ever heard of triclinium? Say triclinium. That's what I said. I had never heard of that, but I just want to put up a picture of a triclinium in case you're like me and you had not yet experienced seeing what Jesus and the disciples may have looked like at a triclinium. Give me just a second. So that's a triclinium, and you can see Jesus seated on the left, right? And we'll go over sort of the placement of the disciples as the other disciples as the story unfolds. The guest of honor would sit at the second seat on the left side, as I just pointed out. You can see Jesus sort of in the white with the drapery over him. Now, I apologize for that complexion. We know in the Middle East they would have been a little bit darker, but this was the best picture I could find. With the two most honored, get this, the two most honored guests will be reclining at his left and right hand. John's Gospel tells us that at one point during the meal, John, the disciple whom Jesus loved, leaned back to speak to Jesus, which would have meant that John was at Jesus' right hand. So in other words, John would be the one who's sort of leaning right in front of Jesus. A Passover table would be set with a bowl of salt water for each three guests. Jesus tells his disciples that the one who dips in the bowl with him will betray him. So one of the three was John. That means that the other disciple on the other side of Jesus would have been Judas. That means Judas had been welcomed in one of the two places of honor at the Last Supper with Jesus. As they came to eat in the upper room, it would have been customary for a servant to offer a gift of hospitality, perhaps a drink of water or anointing with oil or the washing of the guests' feet. With the rough and dusty roads, the washing of the feet would have been particularly welcome. Yet obviously this was not offered, and so once they were at the table, Jesus went to each disciple and washed their feet. If there was no servant, it would have fallen to the host, though. John's Gospel again tells us that Simon Peter, had called to John to ask Jesus about the betrayer, apparently without Jesus's noticing. That would mean that most likely Simon Peter was sitting in the last position. So in other words, Simon Peter would have been directly across from John on the other side of the table, which makes his protest about Jesus washing his feet even more memorable. Peter should have been the one to do it because he's sitting where the host should have been sitting. So he should have been the one to wash their feet. But his neglect allowed Jesus to become the servant in place of the host. Embarrassed by his failure to be responsible, he objects to having his feet washed, but Jesus straightens him out and models for him what true disciples must do and the attitude that true disciples must have for servanthood. During the Lenten season, some of you already know this because I've shared, but not all of you, so I'll share again. During the Lenten season, I decided I would focus on losing weight. Something I started, and hopefully it'll continue well beyond the Lenten season. I decided to join Weight Watchers. Now, I like Weight Watchers because you can eat almost anything you want to eat as long as it is done in moderation and as long as you stay within your daily point allowance. So I'm constantly using my phone, even as we eat meals, and Wanda can attest to that. I'm saying, well, how many points? We were on an HLC visit, and they was like, well, let's go to Popeyes. And I pulled it out, and I put it in the meal. And I was like, well, can we go to Subway instead? So we got in Subway, and I'm like, well, I can't eat that. I can't. So because of the points I had left that day, right? So I ended up getting, I think, like a tuna salad. But the point I'm making is you can eat anything you want, but you got to put in your points, right? So you have to carefully look at what the menu is for every meal to make sure that you stay within your point allowance for the day. Well, at the Last Supper, the menu was certainly at the forefront of Jesus' mind, but not as we may imagine. There were really only two things that Jesus was focused on. Jesus was focused on the bread that he broke and on the cup that he shared. In the Seder, only one of the pieces of unleavened bread, or as it's more formally known in Hebrew, one piece of the matzah, is broken, with a portion hidden away to be eaten at the end of the meal as a symbol of future redemption in the Messianic age. Some biblical scholars believe that the bread that Jesus broke and shared at the meal is known as the aphikomen, in other words, the middle broken piece of bread from the Seder. Jesus gives it to his disciples with a powerful command. He says, take, this is my body. Jewish law had strict prohibitions against eating of human flesh and drinking of any blood. For in so doing, you were consuming the very soul of another, which was considered an abomination. And yet Jesus is giving them a commandment, take, eat, this bread is my body, for I am in you and you are in me. Carrying the significance of future redemption, Jesus is in essence telling his disciples that he is their hope for future redemption. Not some future hope of a messianic age, but in fact, their redemption is there today because Jesus is their hope of redemption. I am the present and future hope, he is telling them. In the same way, when the supper was over, Jesus takes a cup. Paul's description in the book of Corinthians says that it was after the supper that Jesus takes the cup. When the Seder meal concludes, that there's just one cup left, Elijah's cup. Elijah's cup is a symbol of the future messianic age. Elijah's cup is traditionally not consumed, for it is a fifth cup that is poured in hopes for the coming of the Messiah. But Jesus takes the cup and has the disciples drink from it. There is no reason to wait. The Messiah has come. It's not that he is coming. He has come. And the followers are commanded to drink from it, consuming the lifeblood of the Messiah, taking within them the essence of who Jesus is for the world. Jesus is basically saying, you are what you eat. And as you take the bread and drink the cup, we are just remembering and we are re-embodying the risen Christ within us so that we might go into the world and let the light of the world shine through us. The Last Supper of Jesus with his disciples was a redefining of the covenantal meal of the Seder. This is a new covenant with a new sacrificial lamb who will be offered once and for all, a covenant between God and all of humanity. Beloved, tonight we come to the table like the first 12 that we might claim our place within the new covenant of God's grace through Jesus Christ. At the Last Supper, Jesus was at the same time the servant and the host, and the disciples of Jesus are the honored guest. As the host and servant, Jesus welcomed all, including the one who would betray him, the one who would deny him three times before dawn. And he even included the 10 who went into hiding rather than follow him to the cross. None remained with Jesus. If Jesus would choose to eat his final meal with these 12, then certainly he welcomes all of us at the table as his guests, that we might be served, that our hunger might be filled, and that our thirst for meaning is quenched. At the Last Supper, Jesus makes a definitive statement that the future of God's kingdom has broken into the present age, and he takes two symbols of the future, the broken bread and the cup of Elijah, and repurposes them for the church, calling us into the ministry of bringing the kingdom into our midst as it is heaven. At the Last Supper, the disciples then and us now, we do this in remembrance of Jesus, as Jesus has taught us to do this in remembrance of me. Take within themselves the broken bread of Christ. How very significant that it is broken bread, for Christ was broken for us, and Christ died to heal the brokenness of the world. As we partake of the broken bread, we are reminded that we do not need to be perfect to receive at the table. We can and should offer our brokenness to be healed, that we might be made whole. My dear sisters and brothers in Christ, if you knew that one particular meal was going to be your last meal, who would you share it with? Would you share it with close friends? Would you share it with your closest family members? Or would you share it with some famous person that you might want to, I always wanted to meet? I mean, would you be sharing with Beyonce or Oprah or President Obama? Or I don't know. Who would you share your final meal with? Maybe you just wouldn't eat at all if you knew that it was your final meal. But Jesus chose to share his last meal with those who were closest to him, even knowing that they would fall away. But he chose to make his final meal a gift to them and to the church. Each part of the meal was carefully thought out, and he used every moment as a way of telling us that in Christ and Christ alone, we find our salvation. Christ, our Lord, invites all who desire to live in love and peace with their neighbors to come and feast at the table. We are invited to be his guest, and he waits to serve you. If you are hungry, come to be fed. If you are broken or hurting, come to be healed. If you're uncertain and your faith is faltering, come to receive the blessed assurance of Christ Jesus. For Jesus Christ is waiting. Jesus Christ is seeking you. As you come to the table, you will receive a piece of bread, a spiritual reminder of Christ's body. And you will dip the bread into the cup, a spiritual reminder of Christ's blood, and then receive them. And in the receiving of the bread and the cup, you are receiving within yourself the spiritual essence of Christ, that it might empower us together to be Christ's body in a broken world that needs the redemption, that needs the power, that needs the power of Jesus' blood. God bless you, church. Amen.
I'm going to invite all to sort of form a circle here. And